stand with me this morning and let's sing four verses of He Keeps Me Singing.
There's within my heart a melody. Jesus whispers sweet and low. Fear not, I am with thee. Peace be still in all life's ebb and flow. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know. Fills my every longing, keeps me singing.
Good morning. Welcome to Fulton this morning. We are so glad you are with us today on this beautiful, beautiful Lord's Day. And we're so glad you made a choice to come out to the Lord's house and to worship. And if you're a first-time guest with us, we are so glad you're with us, and we hope that you are made to feel welcome here at Fulton Free Will Baptist Church. And again, we are glad you're with us. Let me give you just a couple of announcements in your bulletin. First of all, we are gathering candy for our trunk or treat. There's a basket set up in the old sound room. Again, if it's the old sound room, if you'll just go down this hallway here into that room, there's some clear glass doors. If you'll enter through there, you can drop the candy off, so we hope you'll take part of that. Also, right outside in the welcome area, we are gathering supplies for our Free Will Baptist Children's Home, and September the 18th will be the last day that we collect those. And so just keep that in mind as well. Our children's fundraiser that we've been doing, the tithes that you see out there on the table, we're going to have that up for about two more Sundays, so make sure you go by and vote for your favorite tithe. And the kids are having fun with that. And then tonight we'll be having our annual church business meeting, and so we hope that you'll come back and be a part of that. There's about three items on our docket for this evening's business meeting, so we'll have our regular service. It'll be an abbreviated service, and then we'll have our annual business meeting following that. So please keep that in mind. And then lastly, WINGS, which is Women Interested in Growing Spiritually, will begin meeting on September the 11th at 4:45 and on Sunday afternoons. And so if you need more information, please see Miss Belinda Deal, and she can give you more information on that. All right. Again, so glad you're with us today. If we could get our ushers to come forward, we'll receive our morning tithes and offerings. Let's pray. Our Father, we thank you, Lord, so much for this day. Thank you for your blessings to us. Lord, we thank you for who you are. Father, we thank you for the opportunity to be in your house today. Thank you for everyone that made a choice to be here. And Father, we pray that with every song that is sung, Lord, with every prayer that's prayed, with every dime that's given, Lord, it is for your honor and for your glory. We ask, Lord, also that you'd be glorified in the preaching of your word today. Lord, we pray that you would come and meet with us. We pray that you touch hearts and change lives. And Lord, we just look forward to what you're going to do this day. Lord, we pray for those who are unable to be with us. Lord, we have several who are sick. And so, Father, we pray that you would minister to them, and we pray that you would touch their bodies and heal them. Just minister to them today. And Lord, again, thank you for your goodness to us. And we pray it all in Christ's name. Amen.
Sing once again, Love Lifted Me.
I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore, very deeply stained within, sinking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing cry, from the waters lifted me. Love lifted me.
Sorry, I forgot to turn on my button. For your information, hot off the press, out on our tables out there, we have our new invitation cards. And so I encourage you to go by and pick up two or three and invite somebody to church next Sunday. And because you have about an 8 in 10 chance of them saying yes, about an 80% chance that people will say, if you invite me, I'll come. And so that's pretty good odds. It's much better than the lottery. So I hope you'll go by and pick up some cards and invite somebody to church. If you have your Bibles, turn with me this morning to Proverbs chapter 4. Proverbs chapter 4. We finished up our Life on Mission series last week, and hope that maybe this week, if you've been with us over the last few weeks, that we've been looking at Life on Mission. It was about how the gospel is the center of everything that we do. We learn how we're all a part of community. And last week, we were looking at our giftedness and how God gifts us so that we can serve Him and His church. And so I just want to remind you again, if you were with us maybe Sunday morning or Sunday night where we're talking about the gifts and you want to learn your gift, that there are some easy ways to give you an idea of your giftedness, of what God's gifted you with so that you can serve Him and His church. And so I just want to encourage you again to go to those websites if you need them, or if you don't have it, we can get that information to you, because I believe it's vitally important that every believer knows how they are gifted so that they can serve the church. And so I just want to remind you that this morning. But this morning we're going to look at this idea of watching your step. A couple of years ago, my family and I, when we were in Springfield, Missouri, we got with some friends on a Sunday evening, and our friends' parents' church, they had an annual event, and they had live music, they had really good food, they had games for the kids, and then at the end of the night, they had a big fireworks display, and so we got invited, and so we went, and we had a great time that night. The storm clouds stayed away long enough so that we could have the fireworks and all that good stuff, but there was only one small catch to what we did that night, and that was, beside the church where it was a cow field, and guess where it was? They had the festivities in the cow field. Now, they tried to clean up the cow field as best they can, but you can only do so much with a cow field. So you had to watch your step as you got there. Now, it was during the day, so it wasn't as bad. But what made it really interesting when you was going back to your car after the fireworks, and it's pitch black, And you're walking back to your car in this cow field, and you're looking for headlights to give you any kind of a safe journey back to your car. Well, this morning, Solomon, the writer of Proverbs, wants to give us some advice. He wants us to watch our step in this world. And so what we want to do is take a look at what Solomon had to say. It's almost as like a father is talking to his son, and he's wanting his son to know, wants to make sure that he understands that in this world, you have to watch your step. You have to watch where you're walking. Otherwise, you could fall into some pits. you could get off from where you need to be. And so that's what we want to look at this morning. And so if you have your Bibles, in Proverbs chapter 4, the verses will be on the screen if you need them, but we're going to go ahead and read all the verses, and then we're going to kind of dive right into it. So Proverbs chapter 4, beginning in verse 10. It says, "Hear, my son, and accept my words, that the years of your life may be many. I have taught you the way of wisdom. I have led you in the paths of uprightness. When you walk, your step will not be hampered, and if you run, you will not stumble. Keep hold of instruction. Do not let go. Guard her, for she is your life. Do not enter the path of the wicked, and do not walk in the way of the evil. Avoid it. Do not go on it. Turn away from it and pass on. For they cannot sleep unless they have done wrong. They are robbed of sleep unless they have made someone stumble. For they eat the bread of wickedness and drink the wine of violence. But the path of the righteous is like the light of dawn, which shines brighter and brighter until the full day. The way of the wicked is like the deep darkness. They do not know over what they stumble." So three things that I want us to see this morning as we think about watching our step in this life. Now, again, I'm talking to mainly believers this morning, though we all need wisdom in life. But here the idea is our Heavenly Father is talking to His kids. And our Father in Heaven wants us to be aware of those pitfalls and be aware of our surroundings and be aware that there's sometimes that there are people out there who just really do want to do bad things, who want to do evil things, and that we need to be aware of that. And so if you're not a believer in Christ this morning, I encourage you, as I always say, that's your first step. That's the foundation from where you start, is a relationship with Jesus Christ. It is repenting of sin. It is placing your faith in Him to get you from earth to heaven, to restore that relationship with God the Father. And so if you don't have that this morning, then I encourage you, start there. And so this morning as we look into Proverbs, as believers, I think there's some things that we can walk away from that I think will be practical and hopefully will be helpful. So the first thing that we see this morning is that we need to walk in the way of wisdom. Walk in the way of wisdom in verses 10 through 13. In other parts of Proverbs, the idea is, again, a father talking to his son, and the father wanting to equip his son so that he can have a lifetime of wisdom. But we also know that, again, it's our Father in Heaven who's wanting to give us this wisdom. Now listen, verse 10 says, "Hear, my son, accept my words, that the years of your life may be many." So Solomon here tells us the importance with communication with God. Now, remind us of the story in 1 Samuel chapter 3, verses 1 through 11, of Samuel and Eli. Eli was the priest, and Samuel was his the one in training kind of thing. And so Samuel goes to bed one night. He's a young man. He goes to bed. Eli's in bed. And all of a sudden, the Lord speaks to Samuel. And Samuel's thinking, well, it's Eli calling me. So he gets up and he goes, and he's like, Eli's like, "No, I didn't call you. Go back to bed." And so this happens three times. And on the third time that this happens, Eli tells Samuel, he says, "Go back to bed," because Eli recognizes that it's the Lord speaking to Samuel. And so he looks at Eli or Samuel and he says, "Go back to bed. And if it happens again," he says, "say this, 'Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening.'" Now listen, did you catch what it says? "Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening." That should be the attitude of all of us. "Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening." People must listen if we are to know God. The commandment by Jesus that we are told is the first and the greatest actually starts with these words in Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 4. "Hear, O Israel." Hear. Hear, O Israel. And then many times Jesus would make this statement, "Let him who has ears to hear, let him hear." Right? So the idea is, are you listening? Are you listening? Scientist George Washington Carver was asked once, "What is your secret in all the discoveries that you have made about nature?" And listen to what he said. He said, quote, "All my life I have risen at 4 o'clock and have gone into the woods and talked with God. There he gives me my orders for the day. Now listen, when people are still asleep, I hear God and learn my plan." Can I tell you that we all need to get alone and hear from the Lord, and not just in the big things of life, but in everyday life, in just the ordinary things of life. We need to get alone and hear from Christ. Now, sometimes people say, well, I don't know if it's the voice of the Lord or if it's just my belly rumbling or whatever it is, right? Well, I want you to think of it in these terms. Do you remember the day you got saved? Do you remember that moment where you surrendered to Christ? Did you have to wonder, is this God? Or did you just know? Right? Hopefully, truly, it should have been a moment where you realized, wow, I'm a sinner, and I need a Savior, and it is Jesus Christ, and I need to surrender to Him. But in that moment when you realize that you're a sinner in need of a Savior, did you have to go, well, is this God or is it someone else? You didn't, did you? You knew. Can I tell you, it works the same today. That when He speaks, we will know His voice. Now, we know it's not an audible voice, but it's a voice that speaks to our heart. It speaks to our spirit, and we recognize it. Wisdom also directs us in right or straight paths in verse 11. It says, "I have taught you the way of wisdom. I have led you in the paths of uprightness." Hearing God and accepting His word or His instruction will direct our lives in the way of wisdom. It directs us to the right decisions, and you experience His guidance day after day. If you are willing to do God's will, you will have God's guidance. I promise you that. But we cannot look at God's will like a lunch buffet. We can't look at God's will and go, well, I like this, and I'll take this part of the lunch, but I don't really like this stuff over here, so I'm just going to I'll leave that alone. Oh, no. God's will, it's everything. And if we will just accept God's will, He will guide us. Someone has said, the will of God isn't for the curious, it's for the serious. And that's true. The way of wisdom will never cause us to stumble, in verse 12. When you walk, your step will not be hampered. And if you run, you will not stumble. Listen to just a few verses prior to that. As wisdom is wisdom's way is safe and it's straight. Listen to what it says in verse 3. When I was a son with my father, tender, the only one in the sight of my mother, he taught me and said to me, listen, let your heart hold fast my words, keep my commandments and live. Get wisdom, get insight. Do not forget and do not turn away from the words of my mouth. Do not forsake her and she will keep you. Love her and she will guard you. Wisdom. Now, safe here in these verses doesn't mean that bad things don't happen, right? We all know that they do. But we do walk in freedom, and because that no matter what comes at us, we are still free in Christ. Let me give you a couple examples. A loved one passes away. Just because a loved one passes away, does that mean that you will forever be sad? No. Why? Because if we're in Christ, we have hope. We've been set free from no hope, and now we have hope in Christ. That if that believer who was in Jesus is now safe in the arms of God, that we will someday be reunited with that person. And yes, there is a process of sorrow and there is a process of going through those emotions, but there is something on the other side of that. And wisdom, and remember, ultimately Jesus is the personification of wisdom. On the other side of that, wisdom guards us through that process, and wisdom brings us to the other side. What about a person that wrongs you and hurts you deeply? Yes, there is a process of working through that hurt, but we don't live in the hurt the rest of our lives. Jesus, again, has set us free so that we can forgive that person and move on with our lives. Again, the idea is that wisdom guards us in those moments. Understand this, that because of wisdom, we can live for God our entire lives. He can guide us every step of the way. You don't have to have an on-again, off-again relationship with God. That's not what He desires. That's not what He wants for us. He wants us to live every single day with Him. He wants us to live for Him. He wants to commune with us every single day. And wisdom says, I will guard you so that that can take place. Wisdom is encouraged because it is life-giving. Hear my son, verse 10, and accept my words, that the years of your life may be many. And listen to verse 13. Keep hold of instruction. Do not let go. Guard her, for she is your life. Keep hold, it says. Now, this term, keep hold, reveals struggle necessary to retain one's principles. Keep hold of it. Hold on to it. Don't let go of it. Cling to it. Cling to wisdom. One pastor put it this way. He says, feeble is our hold on God's instruction if it is the mere excitement of novelty or knowledge without conviction, or if combined with some sinful indulgence. Truths received only in the mind do not become the daily nourishment of the soul and are never taken hold of by the heart. Oh, that we truly believe that a soul without true wisdom and grace is really a dead soul. Have wisdom. We must understand that the principles that we say that we hold to in life really do guide us in life. And so if we cling to biblical principle, if we cling to biblical wisdom, then that wisdom, those principles will be what guides us in life. But if we don't hold to those things, even if we say we're a believer in Jesus and we are His, but if we're not clinging to biblical wisdom, then we will get off track. We can allow things in this world to get us off track, because we're not allowing the biblical principles to be what guides us in life. Get wisdom. Get biblical wisdom. I like one person said it this way, keep wisdom and wisdom will keep you. Right? Keep wisdom and wisdom will keep you. On a ship, a crew has to be ready to, at any moment, be ready to abandon ship if necessary. There was a time when an American ship was out fishing for whales and getting whales in the South Seas, and a huge whale that they had tried capturing, it had gotten wounded, and this whale swam out. And then it turned around and it came back and it nails the ship. It just runs into the ship and it causes the ship to begin to take on water. And so as this ship begins to sink, the men get into the lifeboats. And as the water begins to rise and the boat begins to sink, And as the boat, the lifeboats get kind of even with the water, they set sail out from the boat. And they get about 100 yards out into safety. And then all of a sudden, two men jump back into the water and swim back to the main boat. And what in the world are they swimming back for? And all of a sudden, they're gone for a couple of minutes, and they come up out of the water, and there they pop back up, and they have something in their hand. But unfortunately, at that moment, as they pop back up, the main ship goes underwater, and it sinks them down. It pulls them down as the ship goes down. And then a few minutes later, they both pop back up again, and they swim back to the lifeboats. So the question is, what did they swim back for? And what did they risk their life for? What did they have to go get was that special? It was a compass, right? Because in that moment, they had to know which way they were going. No matter what else they were to lose, they were not going to lose the compass, because that compass was their life. Because they're out in the middle of nowhere. And without a compass, you're just going to drift forever. Listen again, Proverbs 4:13. Keep hold of instruction. Do not let go. Guard her, for she is your life. She's your life. Wisdom will guard us. Wisdom will keep us. The second thing that we see is that we need to avoid the path of evil. Verses 14 through 17. It says, do not enter the path of the wicked, and do not walk in the way of the evil. Avoid it. Do not go on it. Turn away from it and pass on. For they cannot sleep unless they have done wrong. They are robbed of sleep unless they have made someone stumble. For they eat the bread of wickedness and drink the wine of violence. It is sometimes hard to admit that friends and acquaintances can lead us astray. Most of the time we think about this in terms of kids, teenagers, but can I tell you, the reality is it's for all of us. Bad company really does corrupt good morals. And so it's for all of us. Now, for adults, we say, oh, well, I'm above that. I'm not going to allow that. It's not true. Because Proverbs was written for adults just like it was for kids or teenagers. Yes, we need to be loving to everyone. Yes, we need to be nice to everyone. But no, we don't need to be extremely close to everyone. Especially those who do not have the same values, principles, or ethics that we do. Those who don't believe the same way we do. Now, the reality is simply this. If you look at your life, you have an inner circle of people that's in your life. It's just the reality of it. It's just the way it works. We may know everybody in this room, and you may consider everybody in this room your friend, but not everybody in this room is in your inner circle of friends. Right? Just the way it is. In reality, in life, when you get to adulthood, you're probably going to have about 10 or less people in your life that you would consider truly in your inner circle of friends. Less than 10. So the question is, who is in that inner circle? Solomon tells us that you need to be careful who's in your inner circle. Whether you're a kid, a teenager, or an adult, you need to be careful who's in your inner circle. If they don't hold to Christian values, and again, it's not that it's not that you're not nice to people, it's not that you're not kind to people, it's not that you're not loving to people, it's just that you're not allowing those people into your life that would have influence, tremendous influence into your life, be in that inner circle. Now, does that mean that if someone's not a believer, that we're to just shun them? No. No, because they need the gospel, right? They need Jesus. So in that moment when their loved one dies, we're there. In that moment when they lose a job, we're there. We're there to help. We're there to support. We're there to be there for them. But that doesn't mean that it's the inner circle. That inner circle, to be quite honest, needs to be reserved for people who hold to, if you're a Christian, if you're a true follower of Jesus, then it needs to be fellow brothers and sisters in Christ. That's just the reality of it. Again, not that we shun anybody, because God wants everybody to come to Him. God desires all people to know His Son, Jesus. He wants every Muslim to come to know Jesus. He wants every Buddhist to come to know Jesus. He wants every atheist to come to know Jesus. He wants every single person on the planet to know Jesus. But that doesn't mean that those who are on the outside of Christianity is on the inside of our life. And so Solomon warns against that. Listen to Psalm 1, verse 1. It says, "Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of scoffers." Listen, there is a progression of sin from walking to standing to sitting. From passing through to spending time to being comfortable with it. That's the idea of Psalm 1:1. This is why Solomon tells us in verse 15, avoid it, do not go on it, turn away from it, pass on. Too many times we as believers, we want to try to get as close to it as we can get without saying we're actually a part of it. And I don't know why we do that. I know we have the depraved nature. I understand that. But if we've been born again, if we have the light of Christ living inside of us, shouldn't we want more light? And he's going to hit on that in just a minute. Also, we need to think about the character of those who want to do evil. Again, listen to 16 and 17. For they cannot sleep unless they have done wrong. They have robbed us, or they have robbed of sleep unless they have made someone stumble. For they eat the bread of wickedness and drink the wine of violence. In other words, they are consumed with fulfilling the desires of the flesh. They live for the next high, and that doesn't necessarily mean drugs per se. They live only for what makes them feel good. Some even live just to make others stumble and fall. Still others are filled with rage and violence and do things to other people. And Solomon says we must be careful around these people. If God gives an opportunity to share the gospel with them, you do it. But we should avoid spending time with people who have no desire for godly things and just want to do their own thing. We must not go down, listen, we must not go down their paths, no matter what that means for us. We are not to go down their paths. Didn't Jesus make it pretty easy? In the sense that he said the narrow path, right? The narrow path leads where? Life, right? The narrow path leads to life. The wide path, the path that most people want to take, the easy path, the path that where the world is headed, that path, where does it lead? It leads to death. It doesn't lead to life. And so Jesus says, follow the narrow path. By the way, he's leading you down that path. And then the third and final thing is that the path of righteousness is light and the path of wickedness is darkness. Verse 18 and 19. But the path of righteousness is like the light of dawn, which shines brighter and brighter until the full day. The way of the wicked is like deep darkness. They do not know over what they stumble. Solomon gives a contrast here of the righteousness and the wicked. And we see this throughout the Proverbs. It's a contrast. This or this. It's a contrast between two things. Here it's light and darkness. It's good and evil. Now, I know we live in a world where we want to say that everything is what? Gray. Everything's gray. It's a gray area. Can I tell you, Scripture's pretty plain. There's good, there's evil. It's black or white. It's man that's created the gray, not God. So, let's look at this contrast. Verse 18 says, but the path of the righteous is like the light of dawn, which shines brighter and brighter until full day. When we come to Jesus for salvation, it is like a light has been turned on. Right? You remember that? We were once walking in darkness. And John chapter 1 tells us that men love the darkness. We liked it. Now, we'll pretend that we didn't, but the reality is we did. Men like the darkness. Because listen, the truth is there is some pleasure for a moment in sin. But it's what comes after that that's sour and bitter. The reality is that when we continue in faith, our understanding of God gets bigger, our faith grows, and we walk in more and more light. And as we continue in the path of righteousness or of light, we will see even clearer how great it is to walk in this light. And it will cause us to not to want to ever walk away from the light, to not go back to the old way of life. Because the old way of life, as we're going to say, it leads to death. And that's where we were. So are you walking in light? Are you walking with the path of wisdom and righteousness? Are you walking God's path? Or are you walking your own? Verse 19, the way of the wicked is like deep darkness. They do not know over what they stumble. The idea is the darkness here is a pitch black darkness. Again, the contrast is vivid. It is light as the bright as noonday in Fulton, Mississippi on this day, right? You walk outside after being in a dimly lit sanctuary and all of a sudden you walk outside and the brightness of the day overtakes you. So Solomon says, those who walk in wisdom, it is like walking in the light of the day. And now all of a sudden he takes a turn. He gives us the contrast, which is complete darkness. Have you been in a room where literally there was no light? Been in those rooms? How many of you stumbled over something while you're in there? Because you didn't know where you was going. Right? So Solomon says, those who are walking in wickedness, those who are walking, listen, quite frankly, all those who are walking outside of Jesus. Because the reality is, everyone outside of Jesus is walking in darkness. That's the reality, isn't it? It's what the Scripture says. It's not what I say. That's what Scripture says, that if you're outside Jesus, that you're walking in darkness. And so he says, in that moment, those who are walking in that darkness, they're going to stumble. It's not a matter of if, it is a matter of when they stumble. And the question is, what are they going to stumble over? What are they going to stumble into? Well, Solomon just makes it plain that if they continue to walk in the darkness, if they continue to go down their own pathway, if they continue to live outside of Christ, if they continue to reject Him, then ultimately it leads to death. For the wages of sin is death. Romans 6:23. It's death. We must hold to wisdom's hand and let her guide us. Let us hold like a little child holds to a parent's hand and let that parent guide and protect us. We've had those moments with our kids, hadn't we? When they're little bitty. You know, they're 10, 12, 15, when they're little. But they're, you know, something spooks them. You may be walking through a store and something spooked them. And they hold on to your hand and they don't let go. And you guide them and you protect them the rest of the way through that place. Wisdom says, let me hold your hand and let me guide you and protect you in life. Cling to wisdom. Now, again, let us hold the hand of Christ because He is wisdom. He is wisdom. Because everything you read about in the Old Testament, it's looking forward to Jesus. It was all about awaiting His arrival. Symbolically, can I just ask, whose hand are you holding in life? Now, for us guys, it's like, I don't need to hold anybody's hand. Right? I'll go down the path all on my own. I can do this. Well, sooner or later, you're going to stumble. Because you're walking in darkness. And it's so dark, you don't even realize where you're going. And sooner or later, you're going to fall. Christian, this is wisdom. This is wisdom. Jesus gave us this book, His book, so that we would know His wisdom, so that we could walk in this life being guided and protected by wisdom. The reality is, the thing we have to come to grips with, and this is really hard, but we're not as smart as we think we are. And when we can come to the realization that we're not as smart as we think we are, that there really are things in life that is beyond us. I'm talking to Christians. Then we'll start letting this book guide us. We'll let this book be the wisdom that guides us in all areas of life. So who's guiding you? Who are you walking with? Who's holding your hand as you go down one of these two paths? Path of light, path of darkness. The choice is yours, and the choice is mine. Whose wisdom are you going to cling to? Let me get you to stand for just a second. Just for a moment, you know I'm not going to carry long. every head bowed just for a moment, every eye closed. If you're here without Jesus, you are walking the path of darkness because you don't have the light in you. The light is Jesus Christ. Because all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Every single one of us has messed up. Every single one of us has broken God's law. And it doesn't matter if you've broken one law or you've broken 1,000. If you've broken one, Scripture says you've literally broken them all. Because we are all sinners who's in need of a Savior. If you're here this morning and you are without Christ, my encouragement to you is surrender today. If there is that voice inside of you saying, you need Jesus Christ, you need Him as your Savior, can I tell you that is the Holy Spirit of God speaking into your life and telling you that you need to repent and you need to place your faith in Jesus. Is that you? Is that you? Are you the one that needs to surrender to Christ today? I'd like to pray for you. I'd like for you to slip your hand up and put it right back down. Be honest. God, you and God already know the answer. Be honest with yourself. Just because you slip your hand up doesn't mean that's going to save you. Know you need Jesus, would you slip your hand up and put it right back down? Thank you for your honesty. I'm going to pray in just a moment. If you need to come and surrender to Christ, then I'm going to encourage you to come as I pray. And someone will meet you here and they will pray with you and talk with you and show you from Scripture. And you can leave here knowing that you're His. Christian, whose wisdom are you really clinging to? Are you truly allowing God's word to direct your path? Are you holding on to the world's wisdom? Are you holding on to your own wisdom in hopes that that will be enough? Do you have relationships right now that as you think about your inner circle and you as a follower of Jesus, you look at your inner circle and you say, wow, I think I've got some people in my inner circle that really don't need to be there. And what do I need to do about that? The reality is, there's times we have to let go of what we may call good so that we can experience better. And truly so that we can experience God's best. We sometimes have to let go of what we call good. Is there someone in your life that you know they're too close? And I may need to distance myself from them. I know it's not easy. I know it's not easy. But it is doable. And God will give you the strength and the wisdom to do it. If you'll just obey what He's telling you to do. If you're here today and you say, Michael, maybe I've been clinging to my own wisdom, or maybe there is a relationship that I have to seriously consider. There's a relationship I really need to be thinking through, and I really need your prayers. Can I get you to slip your hand up and put it right back down? Again, no one looking around. I'm not going to hold you much longer. I'm going to pray, and we're going to be done. Father, we thank You for this day, Lord. Thank You for Your wisdom. Thank You, Lord, for Your word. Lord, help us to walk in it. Help us, Lord, to be faithful to you and to your word. For the one that may be here, Lord, who needs you for salvation, Lord, may they surrender today. For the believer who's saved, Lord, they're yours. They're on their way to heaven. But Lord, maybe there are some relationships that they've allowed into their life, or maybe there's a sin that they've let into their life. And it is not your best. It is not what you desire for them. Father, I pray that you would give them the strength to surrender that. That if it is a sin in their life, Lord, that they would repent. If it is a relationship, Lord, that they need to look at, Lord, I pray that you would give them wisdom. I pray that you'd give them courage. That, Lord, if they need to step away, that you would help them to be obedient to your voice. Lord, help us, I pray. We need you. Lord, this world can so easily pull us away. And so, Lord, we need you. Help us to stay focused on you. Help us to keep our eyes on you. Help us to not look to the left or to the right, but to keep our eyes focused on Christ. Thank you for your word, Lord, and we pray it all in Jesus' name. Thank you so much for being with us today. If we can be of help to you after service, by all means, we want to do that. Also, just a reminder tonight that we'll have an abbreviated service, and we'll be having our annual church business meeting this evening, and there are three items on our docket this evening, and so we hope you'll make plans to come back and be with us for that. All right. I'm going to ask Brother Steve Wood, if he would, to close us out in prayer.